It's a mini episode.
A mini episode.
It's a mini, mini episode. I just broke my phone.
Well, you're gonna have to go get a new phone. On the mini episode.
Good news! It's perfectly fine.
Woo!
Hurrah.
And you can find us on Podbean and iTunes.
So many.
So many. Little itty bitty. Yeah. Itty bitty polka dot bikini. What is that?
Oh, I thought it's itsy bitsy teeny weeny yellow polka dot bikini that she wore for the first time today.
Mine is the cut down version, the radio version.
No, I thought you. At least you didn't start talking about an itty bitty titty committee.
That's a movie, you know.
Is it?
It is. I definitely did watch it.
Coming soon.
No, I watched it.
See what I did there?
Oh, shit. It's about a bunch of ladies that love other ladies.
Sounds like my kind of film.
There you go. This is a What Were They Thinking mini episode. We should probably introduce ourselves.
We're just talking about porno now, aren't we?
Yep.
I'm Nathan.
I'm Brendan. So last week we talked about... Okay, I want to get this off my chest right away, Nathan.
Okay.
Last week we talked about Biker Boys.
Mm-hmm.
With our guest Erica, who was lovely. And I totes forgot something.
Totes my goats forgot something?
Totes my goats for goats. I didn't drop a hint for
awful
the next episode. I know. I am a terrible person. It's almost like I should have a rundown written in front of me at all times because I always run the risk of forgetting something. However, I will give the clue right now. And it may be obvious to anyone who may know this movie, but I'm going to do it anyway.
Okay.
So we'll reveal it at the end of this mini episode, but here's the clue for the movie we are doing next week. Heller! Yep, there you go. And keep in mind, this is February and love is in the air, so that means that Mariah is picking my episode coming out, or my pick, I guess, and Patty will be picking your episode at the end of the month.
Yes.
Yeah. Because love is in the air.
Calm down there, Barry White.
Kick enough your love, babe.
Well, I appreciate that.
I'll just run down the year. So we got February, Mariah and Patty making the picks. We got March, which is gonna, of course, wrestling themed month. April and May are gonna be standard. So we're just gonna pick some movies. June this year is listener's choice.
I have a feeling the still better than postal is gonna be challenged.
Oh shit. Well, I'll just say this. Brent, despite me telling Brent, despite me saying to Brent of the Home Video Hustle, it's pretty early to take picks, but you seem to be throwing movies at me right now, so go ahead. He's already given me his picks. And I'm just gonna say, woof.
Yeah?
We might be in trouble if we pick one of those.
Okay.
I'll let you in on it off air. but yeah, so we've got, that's June. July and August, of course, summer flopbusters. October is a Halloween horror themed movies, and December is Christmas, obviously.
Yes.
Or Hanukkah. Maybe I'll find a good Hanukkah movie.
Okay.
What would that even be like? Eight Crazy Nights or like
Hebrew Hammer?
Now it's just gonna say that one. I was like the one with what's his face in it?
Adam Goldberg.
Yeah, I almost said Adam Driver. That's definitely not it. Although he could still play that role.
Yes.
With that being said, Nathan, what's our topic? Nothing.
Hey, some of our best episodes have turned out from this.
Yep. Well, it's going to do a call-in show, so we're going to take your calls right now. Just call in 1-800. What were they thinking? I know it's a long number, but hey. Let's see if we get any calls.
The lines are not lighting up.
Damn it. We're going to have to start getting controversial, Nathan. So, I don't know. You see any flicks lately?
Biker Boys,
right? Yep. Oh, how was that? Tell me about Biker Boys.
You know what? It was enjoyable. Tour de force, if you will.
This is where I'll plug in the clip of the entire episode from last week. But just your side?
So yeah.
Nobody else's audio. You haven't watched anything at the theater lately or anything?
No, actually, I was... we're gonna go to the theater this past week, but ended up just chilling at home playing video games and watching crap movies because my kids were away and I didn't have to worry about it.
So you were kind of working if you were watching crap movies.
I did watch because I was also playing video games at the same time. Game Over, man.
Oh, that Netflix thing.
It's awful.
I've heard. It's
fucking terrible.
Which is unfortunate because the guys from Workaholics are pretty funny.
Yes. And it's not to take away from that show, but that movie was, it was dreadful.
Okay, well, I'm glad to know it wasn't just like a stuffy critic thing, because I heard like a lot of people say it was bad, and I was like, well, I mean, we'll see. I mean, it's maybe just a dumb comedy, but yeah, that...
Kind of tone deaf and wrong minded, at least in 2018.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Like it doesn't age well, even though it was released this year.
Yeah. Yeah.
Weird.
Yeah. It would have, if it were made, I'd say around 2004, 2003, it would fit in with the movies that were out around that time.
That's very odd.
Well, that was, you know, back then it was still perfectly cool to say, you know, when you're trying to say something is stupid, you're describing it, that's gay.
Really? They have that in it?
Yes.
That's...
That kind of spirit of it, where, you know, the idea of, you know, someone being gay is the joke.
That's so antiquated.
Yeah. So
that's weird. I find Netflix has a track record of that, kind of, with their original movies.
Yeah,
especially like their shows. Like, I don't know if you heard or seen any of that Insatiable show.
No,
but there was a lot of like I don't want to say uproar, but there was a lot of like controversy about that. Like, it wasn't exactly what it was supposed to be. Like, it was supposed to be this, like, you know, eye-opening take on femininity and, you know, sexuality, and people were just like, it is the most tone-deaf thing on Netflix.
Well, because I guess the premise was, like, it was supposed to be the fat girl who got skinny.
Yeah.
And rather than be empowering, the whole show, I haven't seen it, so I can't say, but the whole show, people were like, it does nothing to serve, you know, be who you are and love who you are.
No, not at all.
So.
Yeah, and there's weird things where, like, they have characters being like, I think I'm bisexual, and other characters being like, no, you're gay, and they're like, ah, same thing. Just stuff like that. Where you wouldn't expect it on a show that's... It's not so much that they're saying that. It's like they're saying that on a show where they're pushing forward this message that they're progressive.
Mm-hmm.
It's weird. Like, it doesn't add up.
No.
And I saw the whole... I watched the entire first season. I'm not going to lie.
Okay.
Because it was trashy, and I kind of enjoyed it despite itself.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's definitely not... It's not, quote-unquote, woke, as they say.
Well, okay, so then, I guess... I watched season 3 of F is for Family on Netflix, which is a really funny cartoon show. But it's weird because it's set in the 70s, and the joke or the satire is that of, you know, people being terrible in regards to like sexuality,
yeah,
and race and stuff like that is not a distant history for our society, right? And they're not preachy about it, they just kind of show it out for what it was, and that's the joke. And when I watch that stuff, I'm laughing at it, but I'm not laughing at the idea of, oh, it's because this guy's gay that's funny. It's laughing at the idea, can you believe we were like that once?
And that's the thing. I think that's the difference between good satire and bad satire.
Yeah.
It's you take a thing like South Park, like, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Same idea.
Yeah. Then to watch a movie like Game Over, Man, where I'm like, this is set now. It's kind of frowned upon to act the way that you're acting. And I get it. I'm like, I can't say, you know, be this way. Everybody must be this way. It wasn't my cup of tea as far as, you know, comedies go, because I felt, not because I was offended, I just felt that the writing was came off as kind of lazy.
Well, that's the thing. That's what I was going to say. Even if you're not offended by this kind of stuff, it is lazy. Hmm. Like, to just be like, oh, that's gay. Like, how easy is it to write that line?
Right.
Yeah. I agree.
So, yeah.
I think that's also a major aspect that people are leaving out when people are getting offended that people are offended. Mm-hmm. It's like, no, well, they're also offended because it's just lazy and bad writing.
Yeah, it's like you want me to take time out of my day to pay attention to what you're putting out there, but you put like a lunch break's worth of effort into writing it.
Yeah. Guys, we got all this coke to do. We got to get this script written. Gay bashing jokes? Gay bashing jokes. Let's do it. Or like, well, oh man, there's also like a string of stuff. Like if you watch any of those movies like Wild Hogs or like Old Dogs or any of those kinds of movies, there's so much like gay panic jokes.
Yeah, but with those movies, while I don't care for them, the target demographic, I feel that it would go over well.
Yeah, I just mean, like, it's just weird to see. It doesn't hold up very well. Mm. And it's like, it's weird. The joke is like basically, the joke in Wild Hogs is that John C. McGinley is trying to rape one of them.
Right.
Like, okay. Sure, that's hilarious. Like, I don't know, it just doesn't really hold for me as a comedy.
Well, and again, remember how I said that with, you know, Game Over, Man, if it was written a decade or more ago, people wouldn't bat an eye.
Well, no, they'd say, oh, that doesn't hold up well, but I understand the climate was different back then.
And it's the same idea.
Yeah. I know, I just mean it's not easy to watch now.
No.
Like, back then, we didn't really take it into account as much. I mean, I think people still did, but I think it just wasn't as public.
This is true.
I mean, like, you know, people didn't just suddenly get offended last year, you know what I mean?
No, and that's it. Like, we're definitely now in more of a time where people are lending credence to everybody's at least got a voice, and you should, you know, do them the courtesy of listening, yeah, and then decide whether or not, you know, they're overreacting or if they have a legitimate point or maybe a bit of both.
Because exactly.
I've seen times where people are like just losing their mind over something and they're absolutely overreacting, but they are reacting in a way that does have a valid point.
Yeah. And people that, there are people that overreact to the reactions too, and it's like, it's not, man, this, we're getting deep. It's not even like, people need to understand, like, it doesn't mean these people that are complaining or like bringing up a point, it's not like they're saying, yank this show off the air, you know, boycott this movie. That, most of the time, that's not even what they're saying. Like, if you want to watch it and enjoy it, hey, hats off to you. They're just making a point about how this maybe doesn't appeal to them, or maybe, you know, comes across as a bit crass or, like, bad taste to someone else.
Mm-hmm.
And that's fair.
Yeah.
I got no problem with anyone who wants to be offended by something. Now, if you're going to tell me you're offended by a movie because you didn't like their hat, I'm gonna laugh in your face.
What? Right. So, because, I mean, you're railing against this movie because someone's wearing a dumb hat. I mean, that's... I would be like, are you... You're doing a bit right now, right?
Well, yeah, like, if we made fun of a movie for having bad hats, that's one thing. But if someone's like, you should boycott this movie because those hats are offensive.
And that the first thing I would ask is, you're doing a bit, right?
Yep. Unless those hats had fucking swastikas on them for no reason and didn't serve the plot at all.
Yeah.
Yeah, those Nazis wore uniforms with SS on them. Yeah, that's historically accurate.
Yep. Well, it was like, I got a really good example of this, and I just remembered this. So, we're gonna travel back in time, about 20 years, if not more, when the movie A Time to Kill came out.
Sam Jackson?
Sam Jackson, Matthew McConaughey, based on the John Grisham novel. Yep, okay. So... the movie is a, you know, pretty good movie, you know, and I'm not bagging on the movie, because the movie touches on, you know, racism and, you know, people dealing with, you know, white versus black. When the movie came out, I saw it and I was like, this is really good. The drama is excellent. The characters are well drawn. Kevin Spacey's in it. I didn't know anything about what he was up to at that point. So I enjoyed it.
Mm.
There was a girl in one of my classes who said she didn't like the movie. And I was like, well, why didn't you like the movie? Thinking that, you know, maybe she didn't like this actor or that actor, or she felt that she couldn't follow it or something. Like, she was like, oh, there was so much racism in it. And I'm like, that's the point. The whole movie is about dealing with, like, institutional racism in the South.
Yeah, it's not like the movie is pro-racism.
Right, and she's like, oh, but there was so much racism in it, I couldn't deal with it. I'm like, wow.
That's like, you know, I tried to watch 12 Years a Slave, but there was so much racism in it.
Yeah. Or, you know what? I watched The Diary of Anne Frank. What a downer.
Right?
So, it's situations like that where the point is so sorely missed. And when somebody gets offended or complains about it, and it's like, the thing that you're complaining about is the point.
Right.
That's the joke, as The Simpsons have said.
Yep. As the meme that I've used a million times.
Yeah. So, I mean, I don't know. It does bother me to the point that people it seems like people are constantly offended. But I'm not of the mind where I would say, like, oh, quit your belly aching, snowflake.
Yeah.
It's like, because everybody does. There's a legitimate grain of feeling at the root of anybody being offended. But I think it... How you handle it is really what I'm getting at.
I feel like people take advantage of everything and can make anything look bad, too. So I feel like people who are legitimately offended or, you know, have some kind of issue with it normally handle it fairly well. But I think there's also people that just, you know, the people that are absolutely ridiculous or are completely missing the point make the legitimate ones look bad in hindsight.
Well, do you remember
it's like extremes exist everywhere, you know what I mean?
A few years ago when Stephen Colbert was still doing the Colbert Report on Comedy Central, that show was all satire.
Yep.
And they were covering, a story where somebody had made kind of a racist offhand remark and just tried to play it off as saying, like, they were going to give the money. They were apologizing, and they were going to give some money to charity. And the apology was really weak-willed, and just didn't, it didn't seem like the person really meant it. And they were just like, "All right, fine. Here's some money to a charity. Leave me alone." So Stephen Colbert made this joke about, okay, since it's so easy to get off with that, I'm going to start a charity myself called the Stephen Colbert Ching Chong Chang whatever charity for Asian studies. And that was almost literally the joke.
Yeah. Right?
And, like, word for word. And so the joke being is, like, that he's making is that, one, the person they were talking about just a minute ago doesn't really mean what they're saying. They're throwing money at it to make it go away. So that's going to be the move for everyone from now on. Anybody who is going to make an offhanded, you know, racial remark. Mm-hmm. Somebody got offended that he made that joke.
So somebody didn't look into the context of the joke.
Right.
By simply saying ching chong bing bong whatever he said, just that isolated alone was offensive, but they didn't look into the context of it.
Right. And that's, I guess that's where a lot of it where it comes from is with people being offended, a lot of times I'll say, well, what's the context? How do they mean? Because yeah. Like, if they say something and what they're saying is, you know, I'm all right with this, I'm okay with it, but because they're using verbiage that isn't accepted or the norm, people will get upset at the words that they're using rather than what they're actually saying.
Yeah, and I'll say that, like, there's some words that are exempt from that. Like, I think there's some words that are not, don't need to be in any context. Like, I'll never say the other F word.
Right.
And I won't drop an N-bomb on this show. Like, that just, that there's some words you just don't need to say at all.
Right.
And, but yes, I agree with the rest of it, yeah.
Well, I mean, I think the best way it was ever put, that for me anyways, as far as context and what is said goes, Patton Oswalt had a really good bit where he was like, who would you hate more? Who would you, should you be more offended at? A guy who says, well, I am heteronormative. I do not, and I do support the idea of a person loving whoever they are. However, I'm not for homosexuals being married, as I feel it goes against my heteronormative Christian upbringing. Said very calmly, said very professionally, the words are very eloquent. Versus a guy who's like, what, a couple of queers want to get married? I'm fine with that.
Yeah.
People would more be offended with the dude saying, a couple of queers want to get married, I'm fine with that, because he says queers or something else. Whereas the other guy used 100% perfectly acceptable PC language, but is essentially saying that gays shouldn't be married, and you know what, if you're not hetero-Christian, I don't feel you should be able to do what you want to do.
Yeah, the unfortunate thing about that, I do agree that that's probably what would happen. The unfortunate thing is, I mean, it might be a stereotype to say this, but a lot of people who do say things like, you know, I don't approve of, you know, gay marriage or whatever, usually do sound like the second example more than they do the first.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's it's kind of, there's a strong correlation there.
Yeah, and that's it. Like, you're used to, when people, you know, when they use, I guess, non-PC language, for lack of a better term, it's a knee-jerk reaction to say, oh, they're using that word, they must be against it, and they're bad, and I have to be offended by this.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than saying, oh, well, it's really good that you support gay marriage, but I'm just gonna let you know, man, calling people queer in 2019 is not okay.
Yeah, so unless you're talking about a peculiar situation.
Right. So rather than take the time and have a conversation and just maybe kind of, you know, write the course that they're already on a decent course because they're clearly for this. Just saying, you know, speak better and not being in a way where you're being judging. I've had the same conversation with my dad and my mom several times, but because, you know, children of the 60s, children of the 70s, that sort of thing, versus how things are now. And I'm never like, oh, you guys shouldn't say that. That's not okay. I'll, you know, a lot of times I'll laugh it off and I'll be like, come on, Dad, it's 2019, seriously. You know, and then I would say, okay, well, this is, you know, this is kind of how it is. And a lot of times there'll be pushback. It was like, well, you know, that's not how it was when I was younger. It's like, well, you're not, it's not that time anymore. We got to move on.
We're really bringing the funny this week.
Well, you know, we're not even talking about movies now.
No, this is the politics episode. Let's
see if we can cycle this thing back. God.
So I mean, I saw a couple movies.
Okay, well, let's lay it on me, man.
Oh man. Well, I did see Glass, as we talked about last time. It was all right. I feel like the last 10, 15 minutes was kind of the worst part.
So was is it a situation where it's better than Unbreakable, but not as good as Split?
I do like Unbreakable, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like Unbreakable. I liked Split more, and I think it's like not as good as Unbreakable.
Oh,
did
really?
Did you not like Unbreakable?
Well, it's not that I didn't like it. After, you know, a few years and rewatching it and say, oh, this is actually pretty good. When I first watched Unbreakable, I was waiting for a real drastic twist because that's what Shyamalan did with The Sixth Sense.
Yeah.
Right? So I was expecting something a little more like that. And I didn't get it, so I was automatically let down.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah.
Yeah, I could see that, because Unbreakable was kind of more of a subtle... I mean, there's a twist, but it wasn't as intense as the Sixth Sense.
Yeah.
Or The Last Airbender. The twist is, it's terrible. But you know that twist right from the beginning.
Yeah.
Man, do any of his movies not have... Like, Signs had a twist.
What was that twist?
Something about, like, how the mom knew to swing away or something to that effect.
Oh, yeah.
Right. I don't even remember. It was dumb.
See,
The Village had a twist. The Visit had a twist.
The Visit, I liked. I saw the twist coming, but I liked the twist. And because it was, to me, it felt really like an homage to movies like, Don't Look in the Basement?
Yeah.
I liked it. I loved how they handled the fan footage stuff, too.
I liked The Visit, aside from the cringy rapping scenes.
Yes! That kid's terrible.
That was the worst. But he puts the diaper full of shit in his face?
Yeah.
Wow.
When I saw Signs, I liked that movie because I was expecting a twist, and I was even kind of formulating what I thought the twist was going to be.
Yeah.
And I guess I fell prey to my own wishes not being fulfilled, because when I saw it, I was like, oh, it's going to be like the day the earth stood still, where the aliens are the good guys and we suck. And that's not what happened.
Nope.
It turns out that the aliens are allergic to water.
Which is insane.
Well, not...
Go to a planet that's like 78% water.
Right. That was my thing.
Yeah.
When that happened, I was like, why the... Do they not have scouts? Or, I mean, if they have mastered intergalactic travel, they should have mastered being able to see what is on a good portion of the planet they're about to invade.
Not to mention that they can't go through a wooden door.
Also, the water is so plentiful on our planet that sometimes it just falls from the sky. Why would you go to that planet if you're allergic to water?
Yeah.
And then there's The Happening, which is...
Oh.
Is coming soon!
I hope so. Is there a twist in that one?
Yeah, Mark Wahlberg's a science teacher. Twist! Right at the first.
That is pretty... That is a pretty great twist. It's Shyamalan's only R-rated movie.
Is it really?
Yeah. Only one he's directed, yeah.
I don't know. That's weird. I thought Split would be, but I didn't check the rating on it, but because it's really uncomfortable in a lot of spots.
Yeah, Split does a lot of off-screen stuff, too, or, like, you know, stuff in the shadows, so it's not... able to get away with it. Also... Actually, you know, now that I think of it, I don't think Lady in the Water has a twist. Maybe it does. I don't remember it. I remember.
Yeah, there's a twist.
It's terrible.
Paul Giamatti can be in terrible movies. That's the twist.
Yeah. I was like, come on, Paul Giamatti, you were in Shoot 'Em Up.
I fucking love Shoot 'Em Up.
That's a great movie. Eating a fucking carrot.
Right?
Stabs him with it. Stabs him with a carrot.
We're fans of people getting stabbed with unusual things.
Yeah, like in John Wick.
And like Pumpkinhead?
Yep, with a gun.
Stabbed with a gun.
What else did I see? Oh, I also saw The Upside. The one with Bryan Cranston in a wheelchair.
I've heard not good things.
I actually liked it a lot.
Yeah?
I was surprised. Maybe it's because I haven't seen the original, because apparently the original is, like, a gorgeous, like, wonderful movie, and I think that's why a lot of people are like, ugh, this American remake is terrible. Oh. But I didn't really have too many problems. It's cliched, and it's, like, you know, kind of sappy, but I mean... It was fine. It was good. It was entertaining. It held my attention. It was a little long, but...
Okay.
And, you know, Nicole Kidman was there, so I'm okay with that.
Well, yeah.
She still looks amazing. Just gonna say that. I'm a perv.
That's not enough pervy about that. She looks amazing.
Okay, well, let me get into more details then.
Okay.
Her boobies. If you want to see them, guys, just watch Eyes Wide Shut, I think. I'm pretty sure.
That's, yeah, the one with Tom Cruise and the Stanley Kubrick sex parties.
I don't know if she's naked or if it's just a bunch of extras later in those masks.
Oh, well, that's a possibility.
It's been a long fucking time since I saw that movie once and only once. I did see something else. What else did I see? Actually, I don't think I saw anything else this year. But I am excited because over here in Fredericton, where I live, please don't kill me, we just got a few movies that were recently announced as Oscar nominees, so I'm going to check those out.
Okay.
We got Melissa McCarthy drama film called Can You Ever Forgive Me? We finally got Green Book. And we got The Favorite. I love, 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 love Emma Stone. And Rachel Weisz is pretty good, too.
Yeah.
So, I guess we should tell everyone what we're watching next week.
Yes. Let's dive away from the politically charged episode that this was.
Man, that got intense. Nathan, hit that button. Play that trailer.
No matter who you are,
you're going to be marrying one of the most eligible bachelors in Atlanta.
I love you.
There's always one thing you can count on.
I'm Lisa's sister.
I'm Brian, Lisa's cousin.
Family.
When are we going to meet this man?
He hits me.
Medea? What's going on?
Her man is beating her. Now what should we do?
Before or after his funeral?
Lisa? Sometimes have to deal with things to be comfortable.
You see how nice your life could be if you just do what I say.
Everything's gonna be alright.
That's a black woman's motto. We don't always do what we want to do, but we always do what we have to do.
How you doing?
Would you go out with me sometime?
I got two kids at home waiting for me.
I got a son. We could make this a family thing.
Tyler Perry and Lionsgate invite you to experience the joy.
You know she got two kids, don't you?
I know.
And you still want to go out with her?
The laughter.
Madea is a new foster mother.
I was hoping they would have locked you the hell up.
The only thing locked up around here is your bowels.
The pain.
I love you so much, and I'm going to go to counseling. Just don't leave me.
And the love.
What happened to the pride and the dignity and respect that we had for one another?
Young black man, young black women,
take your place. Starting now.
At Madea's family reunion.
Oh, Heller. How you doing? If you
love this February.
My dad never taught me how to be a father or a husband. We got to be a generation of men that changes that.
Take control. Take a chance. And always take care of your own.
Whenever you come around family, you can find love.
Tyler Perry's Madea's Family Reunion.
Excuse me.
Did that thing just push you, Joe?
Yes, she did. She don't know us. We Baptists. We'll tear this church up.
You better be glad you're a church. Jesus just saved your life. Hallelujah.
Mariah, you're going to hear a breakup on the air.
That bad, eh?
So Mariah has chosen Madea's Family Reunion, directed by auteur Tyler Perry. Good God Almighty, Lord help us all. Nathan, I've never seen a Madea movie.
Really?
Never. I have avoided them like the plague.
Quite a few, actually.
Wow. Okay. Have you seen this one?
Yes.
Are we in for a treat?
I am.
We are going into the totally inconsistent world of Tyler Perry. With Madea's Family Reunion. But that is next week. But as for now, Nathan, why don't you tell us where we can find your good friend, Montrose Monkington III.
Yes, not only my good friend, but your good friend, Montrose Monkington III, can be found on YouTube on Montrose Monkington TV channel. You can also check him out on Facebook, Montrose Monkington III Esquire and Friends. And you can also follow him on Twitter at Montrose III. That's the number 3RD. Thank you. More later.
I was waiting for that. And also, of course, oh, 1 second. Cat, go. You can wait 2 minutes. Also, you can find our podcast, of course, on all the podcatchers. Podbean, www.ttpodcast.podbean.com. Find us on iTunes /Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, all that stuff. And you can also find us on Facebook. Just search What Were They Thinking? On Twitter and Instagram at WWTTPodcast. And we're also on Patreon. Just search for What Were They Thinking? And you can also search for us on Redbubble. And that'll do it.
All right.
That was... Well, all right. Well, Nathan, as we wrap up here,
mm-hmm.
do you have questions?
I guess I kind of do, yeah. I mean, on a podcast where people talk about movies,
uh-huh,
and kind of terrible movies or questionable at least movies,
right?
On a podcast where we said things like "kiss her to keister" and sharing pornography with the elderly, for us to get so wrapped up in, you know, being offended and a politically charged idea behind, you know, race and sexuality, I gotta ask.
Yeah?
What were we thinking?
So I was out with this girl the other night and she said that she hated Star Wars. Can you believe that?
I could top that. My latest date told me he didn't like black and white movies.
What?
Do you have a movie deal breaker? Is there a film you love so much that if your significant other didn't like it, it would be Splitsville?
Well, we're dating hosts Greg and Lauren, and in our podcast, Movie Date Night, we introduce each other to our favorite movies and see if our relationship can survive. And if our partners appreciate the movies as much as we do.
Find us wherever podcasts are available and follow us at Movie Date Night on Facebook or Twitter to talk movies with us.
Hey everyone, it's Chris and Mike from The Recasting Couch, the podcast where we take our favorite movies and discuss what they would be like with new actors in all the lead roles. Hey Mike, tell them where they can find us on social media.
You can find our website at therecastingcouch.com or on Twitter at recastingpod. And of course, you can listen to us on iTunes, Stitcher, Android, or anywhere else you find your favorite podcasts.
Yeah, if there's a service that's not posting our pod, you let us know and we will rectify that immediately.
Damn right.
Thanks for listening, everybody.